in the end, you know, when you have these big fights, one team messes up, the other team gets an ace, and then they win the game. And that's kind of where the game is decided right now. And the big mid-game fight, don't make a mistake.
This is the thing, DaVicia. Like, right now, when there's a lot of league going on towards the end of summer, a lot of LPL was on. Maybe the guys were catching it, watching a little bit more of that. And then there's like, why don't we do this time?
I mean, I think
so far, so good.
LPL has almost been more coordinated than what we've seen from these teams' first two games. Anyway,
I see DaVicia.
Anyway, Bigger Mans. Echo, Talia, Sivir. Same for Unicorns. Same. Jhin was the last ban for H2K. Okay, so now H2K wants to play Vladimir, so they remove Anivia, who is the counter. If Unicorns go Rek'Sai here, H2K will just go something like Vlad Ash again or Vlad Shen. So Unicorns now have to think, should we play Vladimir? So, but then, wait a minute, Cassiopeia is still there.
It tells you that H2K do not rate Cassiopeia from exile in this setting, because otherwise you'd ban the other one that does very well against it, right?
Yeah.
You'd just be like, well, he's played a bunch of Anivia, get rid of that, we don't care about the Cassiopeia matchup.
It's a very specific ban, though.
Oh, yeah.
Almost trying to push him towards that early Vlad pick and give Rek'Sai over to Jankos for some more early pressure, but it's such a specific ban. Like Jhin will be available for Veritas, and Veritas has actually been a good Jhin player if he wants to play it. Now that we know Forgiven is not the biggest Jhin player in the world, it is going to be Rek'Sai again for move. So with this ban here, you would almost expect Vladimir to be a thing.
So
unless they are just like, we're not sure if Unicorns want to still play it, but this is the rotation we talked about, Vlad and Shen.
The Shen was the one I was going to pick up on. Obviously, as you said, the Jhin would be available, so no Ashe in this rotation. This was exactly telegraphed from the Anivia. We may still see the Cassiopeia. I mean, Exile has to play Cassiopeia. Like, looking at the matchups in the mid lane, like, it has to be one that is in his champion pool, so.
But, like, this five mid laners now removed before he has to pick even six if you count Echo. Don't really think it's very relevant for these two teams.
Seen it a couple of times, but
let's keep it at five. Then, you know, Vlad, Talia, Ryze, Kassadin, Anivia. So your champion pool does get strangled a little bit, and you gotta find something new. But that's still, like, I was writing down, like, a tier list for picks.
Yeah.
And, like, every tier is, like, pretty simple to get most of the picks down for, like, everything but mid lane. Mid lane, you're like, all right, here's one pick, two picks, 20 picks, like, that can actually be used in the current meta. So there should be more picks for Exile.
We may see the support of Tahm Kench come out here. If Unicorns of Love don't want to pick both solo laners, the Gnar is fine for them. And hang on, that's been locked in.
There's a Victor.
Okay, well, we asked, what did the Anivia ban mean? It means it pushed Exile onto a champion that is so far out of the meta right now, that has been meta before. But man, I was not expecting
He played a lot of it, but that's been a while.
So I said I wrote down like 20 mid laners. I actually didn't even write down Victor at all as like a relevant pick right now in this potential game. Yeah, sure, he still offers wave clear, but like the last nerf that happened to Victor where his hex core got more expensive as well, actually hurt him quite a bit in the early game. And late game, he's still a monster. If you get him to late game, he's still a beast, but getting there is difficult.
Fun fact, the last time they did pick it up, it was against H2K back during the regular split, and unfortunately, they lost that game.
We've gone full circle.
We have, and Ryu will be laughing at this, because playing into the Victor shouldn't really struggle for the Vlad. Looks like we're getting the Elise come out, probably with the support here to hide the AD carry, because that Jhin potential is here. We've now forced Veritas into a situation where he plays Ashe, and we get to see if H2K pick the Lucian into it, or whether they have picked up Jhin in the last few weeks.
Right, and if they don't play Jhin, it's Lucian or Tristana for Forgiven as like one of the last two picks for him. If Unicorns want to run Ashe, a pick that normally suits them a lot, some comfort.
Oh, I don't know whether I want to see the Lucian.
Lucian wasn't that impactful in the last game. Didn't win his laning phase. Obviously not expected against an Ashe either. Had an okay team fight or two few team fights in the mid game. Was kind of also set up by H2K.
I think I like the Tristana in this case. Forgiven has actually shown he's pretty powerful even in the early game on it, because they can still combo up. Jankos on this Elise should be paying a lot of visits to that bottom lane.
Triss Braum is fairly strong. We will obviously have to see what Unicorns lock in. That will dictate the H2K bottom lane. Lucian is the one that we're going to see from the Unicorns. We may very well see a couple of different picks out here.
Yeah, this is a mind games that often happens in best of series where a little meta in itself kind of suddenly appears between the two teams, where Unicorns are clearly not afraid of Forgiven on Ashe, like at all. So they actually rather remove his second choice, the Lucian. I mean, like, you want to play Ashe, you know, a lot of people would be happy taking the pick.
Now Forgiven's like, Caitlyn.
But Forgiven, like, it didn't work out work out well for him in the last game at all. Despite having some good arrows here and there, they started team fighting way too early, and Tristana is one of these options.
She can
for
jump
him.
The pillar, man. I'm telling you. Last time.
Not to get interrupted.
Yeah, you can get into.
Yeah, that's
so. But so this is basically H2K saying, okay, well, we understand you're going to trade fairly heavily in the lane
there
with the Lucian. So we're going to avoid the trades, but bring the Elise down potentially with the Shen and look for the tower, because that's all we really care about. Yes, Tristana does trade fairly well, but obviously they have to be a little careful around where Veritas is looking to put his damage out.
Yeah, a lot of this, honestly, is looking just at the junglers. Jankos now on Elise, had Gragas 2 games in a row, clearly didn't feel like he had enough of an impact in the 2 games, despite H2K doing fine early game. Like, them dying in the bottom lane to a Rek'Sai gank that is so predictable by now that even Kreppo can predict it on the analyst test.
Wow.
That's a lot.
Wow. That is some harsh burn.
Well, he can't.
That was just
he's
a
not
joke.
Even defending
just a joke.
Oh, that's some banter right
but
there.
But Yamada kind of said it as well. Like, that is the path you see. 2 camps into red buff, into gank, you know. You had 2 wards placed him. Like, come on.
I see how it is. We're getting up to Worlds. You want to undermine as many other cards as you can. Just make
only
sure
Kreppo.
You put him down. Okay, yeah. But, you know, speaking about the gank, Trist has a jump. Braum has a jump. Maybe they won't get so caught out.
Can
this
get
time
interrupted.
Around.
You said it yourself. It can definitely happen. But, you know, we'll have to find out as we get to see the picks and pans one more time. Fade to black.
There we go.
Well, if you guys think that the Unicorns can keep their streak a-rolling and go 2-1, tweet hashtag UOLWin at LL Esports. If you think H2K is going to fire on back this game again with the help of Tristana, Forgiven, hashtag H2KWin is what you want to be sending out there. We'll check those up. We'll tally them and show you in-game a little bit later. But for now, let's load up onto the Rift. Let's see who's going to take this one away. I cannot wait to find out. It has been a back-and-forth slugfest. Mistakes on both sides. A whole lot of fights. And I think it's not going to stop anytime soon. But enough about that. Let's get on the Rift already.
We got to find ourselves a winner. See who's taking third place in the summer split. And will it be the Unicorns bringing back Victor, who has been in the meta the entire year up until the last few patches? But I don't know how they stop Ryu and Forgiven from really getting to the late game without heavily snowballing Veritas. Like, this Victor should not be able to shut down the Vlad in lane.
Again, we're looking at Gnar against the Shen, we're looking at the Lucian, or we're looking at the Lucian in the bottom lane as like the 2 picks you want to get rolling early, especially if Chachi. Getting Rift held is actually really huge. The buff is fantastic, it's just taking it is fairly risky, you know, you take a lot of damage, you need a lot of members, or you need the other team to be on the other side of the map, basically. So it's hard to coordinate, okay, now we go Rift Held specifically, or like in 1 minute. If they do get it, like last game for Chachi, yes, he becomes that split pushing force. Yes, he should use it and just have that pressure in the side lane. And then, of course, Veritas. We saw the Black Cleaver Ghostblade built from him last game. Want to see more of an impact in the mid game from him. H2K with that last team fight in the last game, it cost him everything. Means now it's 1-1 and Unicorns of Love might mentally now have the upper hand.
Yeah, very possibly. I think Veritas can pretty much afford to go the Black Cleaver route again. It's still fun.
Less tanks.
There's a little bit less tanks. Of course, Vlad will build tanky, but not build armor. That's the caveat to that.
Yeah,
it's like,
I'd definitely go for the Ghostblade build in this game
when
you're against so many squishy members. Like, people look at Braum and go, he's a tank. Well, he's a support who gets like a luck hit, and then if he's lucky, he gets actually a full completed tank item after.
And then when his shield's gone.
And then when
suddenly.
His shield is gone, yeah, he's no longer a tank. And armor penetration is, of course, extremely efficient then, the flat armor penetration. Funny enough, we get standard lanes. I was about to say, wow, standard lanes again. But
how could you predict? Yeah.
So we've all heard of the fateful level 2 spike on the Lucian. But the level 2 spike on this duo lane from the Trist and Braum is fairly difficult to deal with as well. The jump forward with the bomb, the Braum Q is very easy to proc the passive from, so we may very well see a big fight around level 2 as these two teams head off in the bottom lane.
There's also a high chance we just see H2K kind of go for the farming.
Just
wait for Shen level 6, wait for Jankos to actually be around bottom side, and then try and go for that kill into a tower, because we know Tristana, once she gets to the turret, she can't take them down really, really effectively. But most of her lanes are not fantastic. She doesn't really bully anything in the laning phase specifically. So they will get pushed back. And they're already sitting near the tower. Boom is around the bottom side again. Not looking to gank. He's getting the Rift Scuttler.
So is Jankos, though.
Here's Jankos slightly later. He's too late for the party.
Scene move. Yeah, it is too late for the party.
For the party as well.
It's both.
Yeah, both works.
Still counts. All right, but he did manage to get some vision out there in the jungle. It's just been trading back and forth on that. Chachi had no trouble in this matchup last time around. See if things change as he hits Meganar. There's a duke it out a little bit with Odawamne just over the farm fest. There's a big difference in CS up top, though.
There's a big wave. Yeah.
That's true.
It's the same for the bottom lane, why it's getting even back up. Just the way the ebb and the flow of the laning phase go. Once you concede the level 2 and the early levels, you just let them stack minions up. You don't last hit them because otherwise it pushes further back away from you. Makes the next couple of levels a little bit more difficult. That's where you see these swings of farm just in the early game. Back and forth, and it'll even up eventually.
It's much more about who can do it consistently, and also where the jungle is moving with it. Jankos down towards the bottom lane. There is an overextended support and AD carry.
And Veritas instantly exhausted. The bomb is on, and in comes Forgiven. They're looking for Veritas. Illisank trying to block, but Veritas is going down. First blood to Forgiven, and they're looking for more. They should be able to secure this to jump forward on the reset, but no, not enough, and Forgiven flashes back.
You even had to flash in the end, but as we talked about, if you are this Tristana Braum lane, sit back, wait for your jungler to show up. Didn't even need the level 6 on Shen. Jankos just moved behind them. Finds Illisang.
He nails the cocoon! Explosive spiderlings on, not enough damage. Jankos is stopped up. He may need to rappel out of this one. But looks like he's got enough leisure time to start on a Krug.
It didn't go in with the damage from the Q from Jankos there, so didn't want to all in. Didn't want to throw himself away. Didn't have quite enough vision to know exactly where everyone was. But how many times a team's gonna do this? In these moments in the early game where after the first clear, junglers have the easy path into the bottom lane, being shoved up without vision control behind them. Like, great river vision control, but if you know exactly where Jankos is, but you're not watching the path behind you, and suddenly in comes the Braum passive to lock down, Forgiven picks up first blood.
The problem is, if you look at the minimap, you see two wards near the dragon, which actually cover the same area.
Yeah.
You need one of those wards to be placed. Obviously, one with the Rift Scarlet, the other was a ward. That one ward should actually have been placed further up the river, so you could see Elise path towards your jungle and move behind you, because Elise is one of the junglers who can't jump the dragon wall. So she has to walk through the entrance towards you, or behind you, basically. If you have a ward there from your mid laner, you spot that path from Elise and you don't overextend. So that was a bit of a problem for Unicorns. They actually had a Rift Scuttler and a ward giving the same vision, and no vision around the mid lane where Jankos could just path in, move down behind them and get an easy first blood.
And Jankos knew the way it was clear because he had already placed the ward down there a little while ago, Ryu going a little bit low in this matchup to the Death Laser. But yeah, big, big mistake down on the bottom side. And it nets Forgiven a really quick BF sword here. In a matchup that Tristana is not always going to win early on, it's going to turn the tables a little bit more.
Ryu's going to be careful. The disco ball's out and he doesn't feel like dancing at this
point.
Today. Oh, back
and
to the bottom.
We're going to have some dances there. Veritas does take some bomb damage. Turns on up to Vander, who throws the Unbreakable down. Hillisang taking a little bit more in return. Everyone's okay.
And the significance of that BF sword, actually, XL wants to dive here. He actually wants to try and get the damage down
level
onto Ryu.
Level 6 on Shen.
On the tower.
Oh, he's stopped. There's the Shen ulti. And they're coming in. Jankos leading the charge. Can they get there in time? No.
Yeah. Right. The bait.
Not
Ryu. Gets stunned, and then the Shen ulti comes in. And it's like, we can't actually chase.
Not the greatest Shen ulti I've seen.
Ends up being used here from Odamne, all because of the bait being set up by Ryu.
And the teleport burn. Now, Jankos has found Move here, but Move is actually dealing a lot more damage back towards him. And fortunately for Move, Ryu's already coming to the party, so now Move has to flash over the wall, avoids the gravity field. And he's out.
Not the tidiest of early games here by
not
both
the tidiest
teams.
Series,
no,
let's
that's,
be real
that's,
here.
That's very true. A couple of little weird plays, just holding on and Move not really respecting the cocoon, but getting himself out after all. A couple of summoners burned, but Move wants to come bottom in here. Vander wants to push for Veritas.
Vander, he's taking Vander. Everything. Unbreakable, no more. Move takes the kill.
Oh dear, that is.
I don't even know what's happening.
What caused Vander actually to tank that?
I mean, surely he just tried to proc Q on Veritas to force him away because they had a massive minion wave. But Jankos was on the bottom side.
And why would you run in?
So Vander moves forward, obviously. Tags the Q onto Veritas and then keeps chasing because he thinks, okay, my jungler's here, so we're gonna just force Veritas off. If he stays, we're gonna kill him. But then Move is already here in the bottom lane and just picks up a very easy kill, stops the push from H2K, and that bot lane tower now is sitting on like 50% HP, but they can't do anything more. This is the play, so he knows Jankos is coming.
So push him back.
Push him back.
Away.
If he stays, you dive him, Move shows up. You have zero vision in the enemy jungle.
So effectively, Vander's assuming he'll take maybe two turret shots and then have backup with him because,
and
as you said,
out of tower range
exactly.
By then, and Tristana can jump forward, obviously force Veritas to then flash away. Yep. Problem is, when you have zero vision in the jungle, yeah, the enemy jungler can, funny enough, be there. And
it's
you die.
That does work out sometimes. So it's 1-1 on kills right now. Big mistake. I allowed Unicorns to grab one back for themselves. It was in Move's pocket. He got the first blood last time around. We'll see what he does with that gold. He actually has been up in CS here. Jankos has been more on the ganking path for this Elise.
He has been. One thing we're going to consistently see in this series already, we've seen it already, I should say, is the supports just leave around this time and just go, well, we're going to go ward, we're going to go try and find a jungler, go pair up, and we'll leave AD carries on their own. Only problem for that is Veritas just recalled, and that tower is in danger in the bottom lane. Already half health and under.
They're going to take it down now with Tristana. So effective, especially after getting PF, just taking down these turrets. And this time around, HK did also play some deep wards towards at least the entrance of Unicorn's jungle to see where Move is.
They learned their lesson.
They're going to spot him very soon near this Raptor. Don't actually commit fully for the tower. Want to get the recall off instead on the side of HK. We're sitting on quite some gold. You get
they got two-thirds of it
full
down.
Boots,
though.
You get Longsword. And technically, you can just return there if you are H2K and now set up a play where you have Shen ulti's backup and get down that tower. So they value the recall other than trying to rush down a tower and then maybe not even getting it in time because Veritas shows up with ulti as well.
Some of the value in this is Vander now being able to replenish wards. They all buy pinks, that kind of thing. You get that extra time just to control the map. If you rush down that first tower and overcommit to it, there's obviously the potential of that wave getting pushed away from you, and maybe Veritas or Chachi end up getting a wave pulled into them. It's large, sizable, you lose a bit of farm, so don't want to overpush too early, but of course they're looking for that first tower blood. Get that extra gold for the team. H2K have been so good at doing it. Didn't get it in the last game, though. We'll see if they can do it with the Tristana. It's highly likely that they will.
Yeah, because not able to find any success here in the early game other than that one gank in the bottom. Quite some success, but apart from that one gank, he's not been able
to kind of
continue it.
For one of the first times, he's now down in CS, though, to Move at the same time. Move has the kill, has had, you know, arguably this equal or perhaps more presence in the game by being able to just kind of pick up a kill in the bottom lane when H2K overextend. But the first game in this series that actually Move is hanging on with Jankos in the early game. That's not fair. He got a kill early in the second game. I'll give him more credit.
Yeah, well, he's definitely been impressing. Since game number two, continues to do so. Veritas spends a full channel of the calling. Forgiven can't quite finish off the tower. He does rocket jump his way past the pillar, and now Move and Jankos are mirroring each other, but Move is the one spotted by the ward.
Yeah, and again, HK will get this
tower
eventually.
Flash the Glacial Fissure.
It's all on Unicorn.
Back around. Here we go. They want the 3v3. I don't know if Unicorns are on the same page there, though.
No, and if you are Unicorns and you do force a fight in bot lane, as soon as you see Shen ulti, just back away and let Chachi get that top tower.
He walks right forward here onto Exile. Does he have the damage to finish him off? Not quite. Get ghosts on both sides, you.
Everyone backs away. We can remember, if Shen does ulti away, Chachi gets a lot of damage on that top tower. So as long as Unicorns don't fully commit, but just force that Shen ulti defensively and then step away, they can actually force H2K into a very bad situation. But if they don't do anything at all, H2K will eventually take down this tower. It's
just a
few more hits.
They do tag Hillisang with the cocoon.
Ryu is coming.
Jankos, the pillar was stopping him from getting where he wanted to. Ryu is here. They're going to make the power play. This is the time to get the gold lead in your favor, take down the first tower, and they will do it at 11 and a half minutes.
And just Ryu's presence alone, showing the extra numbers, is enough to force the Unicorns back away from the tower. No reason for H2K to overcommit there, no reason to dive. You want the tower gold, that's it. Nothing else necessary.
Yeah. And now you just want to push another wave and then recall your bottom lane and take them to the top lane. See if you can save this tower before Chachi gets it down, and then you get quite a good early advantage. You don't want to go for early dragon here. The Ocean Drake is not worth it compared to defending another tower. Good player for Amne. Finally, he gets the taunt on Chachi on the tower.
But not within range of
Sadly.
Just
he got the damage on him.
Yeah.
But he, again, holds the tower. This is the play you were talking about, DeFicio. Look at the top of the minimap. In come Tristana and Braum up to the top lane. It denies Chachi the push onto the tower, and now Unicorns are in a tough old spot because they're going to be, in the end of all things, two towers down. And look, the recall is only just coming out from the bottom lane from the Unicorns, so they are behind the curve once again. And Odoamne stayed to make sure he could push that wave out so that they get there as fast as possible for tower damage.
Yeah, Unicron's reacting to try and defend another turret, which will still take some damage from this Tristana, and we've just seen what happened. If you continue to 2v2, well, HRK keeps pushing it in now with Forgiven being slightly ahead, and then constantly get some damage on tower. Bigger spike here, though, for Veritas with the Ghostblade completed, but you always gotta remember that Shen ulti every single time you wanna fight, it's right there in your mind. You're like, okay, Shen could join.
Ooh. Oh, move.
Nah, he's ganking the pink ward. Ganking the pink ward.
There we go.
Spotted out on the ward, so knows that there is no further path up the top, but Jankos is here as well. Shen ult, keep in mind.
Ooh, almost walked right into it.
It's the same kind of situation for H2K. If they are forced to use defensive Shen ulti, they might lose the bot lane tower for it and don't really get a whole lot. If they can push all the way to tower and actually use it aggressively or use Jankos aggressively because he knows he has the backup of Odo Amne, they're going to be able to take that tower as well and keep the tower lead.
Exactly, and it's about the net trade, right? Is you trade the towers, you're still one tower up, and you potentially have position for Rift Herald. If the fight goes well enough, you can deny it for the Unicorns, whereas the fact that the solo laners are on the bottom side makes any kind of dragon presence very difficult. Hang on, move, and Jankos going toe-to-toe. Jankos is in the lane!
Goes right on in, and there is everybody ulting, and move is just gonna get melted through by Ryu. They turn their attention right over to Exile right now, and that's a double kill for the Vladimir. Chachi comes in, looks a little too late, but Odowame is on the wrong side of this inner tower. Chachi's gone! Jankos picks him up, and they do not lose a man!
And this is why it was so important for H2K to not be forced to use defensive ultis from Odowame. This was a very aggressive play, but when you know your top laner can join so quickly, you can stop playing around, diving the enemy, even 2v3, like Jankos is set up here for H2K. Chachi goes down, Exile goes down, and Move goes down as well. So many kills because now you can use it aggressively. Your minimap here, guys, you see Shen move very far back behind his tower so he can't get interrupted. Set up the play, pick up the first kill. Nice disengage from Jankos as well. And now you have Vladimir and Shen sitting here. They don't care about your tower.
And now you've got a Gnar with no TP. Nice cocoon from Jankos over the wall to be able to pick that one up. You've got a Gnar with no TP. You've got a Tristana and a Braum trying to hammer down top tower. So if Chachi even shows in the bottom lane, the same play can happen on the top side with Odo using teleport. They would obviously trade that tower, but H2K have got so much over these plays that that's an acceptable loss.
Because it's the same thing again. Even if you don't use the global, the enemy team knows you have the global.
Yeah.
So if they start chasing you for like a kill, well, you're gonna TP behind them, so they will never chase you for that kill. And then you get pressure in the lane automatically by having a second global that the enemy team doesn't have. So it's all about mind games, essentially, and these extra cooldowns you can use to allow Forgiven and Vander to move in, give a few hits on tower, and know that Odo Amne, the team player, is always ready.
Yeah, he is, and they managed to make a big play there, swinging the gold in their favor. It's 3,000 up at 15 minutes into this game. They keep the pressure topside. No need to worry about the Ocean Drake down bottom. They have all the control they need. Jankos
can also TP dive.
Coming on in. They're looking for the dive. The calling's been spent already, but Move has already answered right on back, and Jankos is forced to repel.
Odo Amne wasn't in the right spot in the lane. He was getting attacked by Chachi as he was looking to find a TP position. And you can see Chachi's going to try and punish him just by shoving as hard as he possibly can into this bottom lane. Will transform into Mega now, which means obviously he can just kind of bully around and not really do too much damage to Odo Amne himself. But it's a settling moment, though.
Good reaction here from Unicorns as well. Understanding, okay, tower dive can happen top with the TP from Odo Amne. Move the Exile up very quickly. Move was there as well to defend, stop the dive from happening. And it's all about, again, Chachi extending his goal lead, or his CS lead, and then get that tower down. Like, you need now to get these towers because you're chipping away on top tower and bot tower. It was, you know, down under 50%. But if you don't actually kill them and cash in, well, then it means nothing.
Yeah, they're doing what they need. They're getting stuff around the map. Jankos is able to solo out Ocean Drake, so that one falls. Just shy of 17 minutes into the game, the gold lead staying the same for them, but HK are looking to push forward and fire down turrets. They've still got Tristana Braum hammering away up top.
And Victor has done nothing. Not that we expect him to do anything.
Right.
Like, he needs to sit and farm and scale into late game. But
you have to call into question the pick again.
Of course. Like, you have to call into question the fact that a lot of mid laners feel they are 10 plus very viable, strong mid lane picks in the current meta. None would pick Victor.
No. Well, Exile might.
Yeah.
But this is the thing.
This is a guy who came in, you know, effectively out of solo queue, and he had grown up quite a lot over the split. But if he's not feeling confident enough to play Cassiopeia into a Vladimir, you still have to question, you know, is he ready for this kind of stage?
I think it's a little too harsh on him specifically. Like, there were 5 mid lane picks removed here. And
that's true, they did have a lot of targets.
And obviously, Unicorns have had a lot of success with these specific picks. So for him, obviously, that's where he's been focusing a lot on being as good as possible. But that, again, is what happens in BO5s. So people will target champion pools. And while it looks really difficult right now for Unicorns, like, we're waiting to see what Exile can actually do late game. Trying to match someone's scaling of Vladimir.
Good knockup. Double knockup. Okay, Exile has come around the angle here. Hemo plagues on. Yankos is looking for him in the back, but he might have found himself down. One more hit would do it. Veritas finishes it, but Ryu's right there, forcing the summoner heal out. Sends the autos, not enough. Going in, Ryu get the killing spree on that one, and he's going to try to pull his way to safety. And behind Vander, and they do keep him alive.
Got that empowered transfuser.
Here comes Forgiven. Oh, just out of the blue. He's firing him down. Exile taking out the reset. Double kill, hopping forward, looking for a triple onto Hillisang, and he gets it. Oh boy, is Forgiven having a good day.
Massive triple kill is gonna swing this game around. Odoamne was down in the bottom lane.
Did he just get the kill?
What? Was Chachi TPing out and Odoamne just killed him?
We're gonna have to see that one again.
We are gonna see that again. I'm sure we'll get it in the replay. This will transition into the top tower that HK have been looking for so long. The triple kill puts Tristana now 4-0.
They get everything.
Oh, it is. And Forgiven must be just completely ecstatic with that kind of trade. On a Tristana, let's take another look. How did this happen? Was it a taunt under the turret?
Right,
did he do it?
Yeah, so no, he stops. Ah. They're ulti from Odoamne, and then Chachi try. You can't TP there!
What?
At least walk around the corner! You have a pink one in a bush over here, at least walk into that!
Oh dear. Well, we're gonna watch the end of the trade here. Chachi trading somewhat in the minions, Odoamne with the damage.
Forgiven.
And this is Forgiven going off.
Also, Ryu setting that up really well, flashing in and then pulling out.
Full credit to Ryu for that fight. Yeah. Diving into the backline, picking up kills, soaking up so much damage.
And Vander saving his life in that really clutch moment. And that was such a sick
I almost want to see the replay of the bottom lane again.
why did Chachi think he could deal? Oh, Ryu, hang on.
Yeah, okay, three people right there. And no amount of pool is getting you out of that one. He does throw a three-man Hemo Plague. But he is going to just try and keep himself alive. Not happening with Boo.
Gotta have won a game. Gotta have won a game. Great fight into bottom lane, trying to get a kill. Maybe we'll see the setup for this one. Maybe this one was just trying to catch.
Just this time last game, he was in the same score, actually, funny enough.
He was. Last game we didn't see the lead up to it. So this one for you just out. Why was Chachi trying to TP there? He's like, I'll cancel his TP. He can't do anything to me.
Oh, I don't know if he thought Shinra Taunt was on cooldown still. That seems to be the only thing you can kind of realistically see.
And then he runs out of Meganar.
That was quite a play. They will get a bot tower for it.
All right, worth.
And now the diamond.
HK, they're looking for more. Finding Exile. In comes Forgiven and takes him out. Move is caught with the rest of the team trying to tunnel away. That should be an inner tower here. H2K are really starting to fire on all cylinders. Chachi coming around the side. Omega cannot take it.
Oh, H2K can't take the tower for now. They have to back themselves away. And again, this is like the discussion of acceptable losses. For H2K, bot tower to lose is fine here. As long as they can get more from this, that is absolutely fine. Odoamne looking to come around the side, looking for a taunt under tower.
Oh. There's no Meganar available. They found Chachi, and they take him down straight through the calling of Veritas. Ooh. They don't even care. They get themselves an inner turret, starting to march forward on the base. H2K way ahead in this game.
Yeah, such a good position for H2K. Played it. A good early game, and now finally got a lot of kills picked up as well.
Oh, look at that tower damage.
Punishing Unicorns of Love over and over. You got 5 kills now on your Tristana. Already 2 full complete items. Super Forgiven is probably way above 1,000 gold again now. 1,400 he's sitting on. They can go straight back to base. That's great, by the way. If you go back to base, use all your gold, step out for like 1 minute, and you go back again, and you have like almost 2,000 gold ready.
He's 2,000 gold ahead of Veritas on his own. Let's take a look at this fight one more time.
Yeah, this is H2K. A little bit, split focus here. Obviously, they drop the turret, but the fight is juicy for them. They go for Exile. Get him instantly in this fight.
Yeah, 2 members from Unicorns went to side lane to see Veritas recalling in the bottom lane.
Chachi not quite there. Yeah.
Very easy call here for H2K, and really the only way out is that you very early flash as someone like Exile, because you know they're gonna engage onto you when you try and wave clear. Another good engage then, Odoamne comes in with a taunt, another kill, get the tower as well. H2K in prime position to win this game now. And so little Unicorns can do, because this Victor is still not even close to coming online. Like, he has only Hexcore fully completed, and that's about it. And like your AD carry, yeah, he's building for this mid-game spike, but he can't do anything on his own.
A mid-game right. About to end.
And this right here, these items is the strongest that Black Cleaver, Ghostblade, Lucian, comparable to other champions on the map, if everything was even, should be. Unfortunately, he's like half an item behind against a Tristana that's 5-0, who is going to outscale him anyway, and that means the AD carry matchup is gone for the Unicorns. There is no way your Lucian is going to outdamage this Trist.
They need a miracle fight, and honestly, it's so hard to see that happening. HTT get themselves another easy dragon. It's a more regeneration if they want to keep those fights going. 23 minutes into this one, HTT still look like they can close it out. It may be a little while, but they are moving themselves forward.
Yeah, this point here, if you're H2K, you can start setting up around Baron. It's always going to be a fairly easy objective for you to take down with the three-item Tristana once she hits that point very, very soon. Or at least use it to force the fight. Because now, really, your two turrets you're going for, the two in the side lanes, can be a little bit difficult now that you don't have, like, multiple paths you can take towards enemy jungle. So Baron is the logical choice, and they find the sneaky ward outside as well. H2K getting the jackpot.
Pretty
the support jackpot when you find that one ward.
That one, yes! Yeah.
They didn't clear the last Unicorn's ward, though.
Pretty quick Baron as well.
Yeah, you do
H2K
need,
have.
So when you play red side, you actually do need a pink ward, both outside the Baron pit, but preferably also one inside. Well, actually, you don't even need inside too much, because people will rarely get to sneak in that ward. Just sweep inside, put the pink ward outside the Baron pit, so you spot everything near that Rift Scuttle area. And then you're gonna be fine.
This is why blue side's superior to Vishio.
There we go.
You don't need that extra pig.
Well, no, you only need that one pig outside. Again, the one inside, that's
you don't
a lie.
Need to sweep.
Just sweep inside, yeah. You gotta sweep inside.
Chachi fancying himself to fight bot lane again. Not sure he really wants that. About a half an item ahead, Frodo.
This happens so often, though, guys. People or teams are like, all right, I set up the pinks, clear enemy wards, and let's all recall.
Yeah.
So now you just gotta do the same thing again, technically. They did get some few new pinks. But
at least they bought them again. Yeah.
They did buy them again. That's been a mistake we've seen from other teams. But now you can just go back and kind of place the same ward. So at first we're just
it's
placeholders.
Your dance.
They're like, yeah, we know, okay, this is where we had the last ward. This is where we had it. Just place the exact same wards.
They'll never check again.
And we're gonna be fine. And this time, when the enemy team shows up, we have our items. We have three items, Tristana. Either we take the Baron for free or we destroy him. Oh, we sweep inside the Baron pit. Now pink outside.
There's the pink.
No, the ward is sliding too far away.
This is the whole vision range, you know, invisibility detection range.
But that ward is so far away that if you stand on the right side, like Forgiven does
Forgiven
now.
Forgiven can just auto-attack him out.
The ward doesn't actually see Forgiven hit the Baron.
Oh, wow.
Well, they know it.
Now we see.
I don't know if they can stop it, though.
Don't worry.
It's at 4.5 thousand.
Yeah. But they know it.
Coming
they know
in from Chachi. It might be a little bit too late. They've turned their attention off the Baron. Yankos is still taking a lot of damage from it in the pit. This is split focus here.
Secure
the Baron, and now the fight is going to be on Veritas and Exile dealing with this Vladimir, or can they even? Ryu is massive. They've caught Exile, exhausted,
the wolf
right
camp.
Into the wolf camp, and aggroed it. There goes Yankos hopping on up. One more auto for Forgiven.
It's a jump.
Gets himself a reset, looking for Chachi now. Not enough damage, but this should be an easy tower.
Very easy tower going over for H2K here. Baron buff means they're likely just going to keep this bulldozer rolling through the base.
Give it dozer. It's coming.
Dozer.
Get him to that tower.
Just one bomb should be enough to take this down. There is no way this tower's
alive.
Look at that damage.
That's disgusting. Inhibitor should be pretty easy. It's 26 and a half minutes. HGK, all we've got to do is keep this going, close this one out. Unicorns are going to try a desperation fight here. Move is around the side, spotted by the pink ward. Yankos and Odo a little bit low. In comes Meganar. Chachi, Ryu instantly goes away from that, and Odo is still tanking. Move is looking for another one. Another pillar flash from Hillisang. The fight is still on. Chachi's going down. Yankos picks him up. Exile's back in base.
Well, he was dead still when they tried to re-engage.
Yeah.
Desperation definitely for Unicorns of Love. You can't win without your victor. Despite it being 0-4, you still need it there for that potential fight.
Didn't look like Chachi could get the ultimate in time either. Something must have been disrupting him, and Forgiven had already jumped
maybe
away.
Taunt again?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, he has nightmares now.
Odo Ame has been taunting, and the crowd have started to come alive as H2K lead this game 13 kills to 3. This has been all about H2K right out of Champion Select. And again, Odoane Vander just gonna block here. Ryu is just blocking the top side as well, because it's not about H2K putting damage down yet. They're waiting for Forgiven and Jankos two-man, and now they turn. As soon as Baron drops low enough, the turn is on. Forgiven goes right after that top laner and just goes, okay, you want a 1v1? Let's go for it, because Ryu is in the back line fighting them. Wolfcamp saves Exile for a little bit as he was adjusting his way out.
To block him
yeah, exactly. You know, friend for a little bit.
Yeah.
Not so much for the rest.
No, it's a rough game when the Wolfcamp is against you as well. Move is now behind the enemy line.
Uh-oh. Unfortunately, he thought it was still his own jungle, but he runs straight into five members of H2K. And what the hell? Give Vander a kill this game.
Well, if it wouldn't have been easy for enough for H2K to push the remaining turrets on the map, that's going to make it just that little bit easier again. Move. Another death, just in the own jungle.
That is
a little bit
all
out of
the
position.
Turrets outside of base that Unicorns have lost here. They've only been able to take one for themselves, the one down bottom. It has been a real rough game for them. Unicorns will be scratching their heads, looking for some answers after this one finishes off. But for H2K, it is looking great. They will be one game away from a third place finish.
Yeah, Unicorns definitely are thinking about the pick and ban phase. Sheepy sitting backstage, figuring out, you know, blue side again, because obviously Unicorns will have side selection in the next game. They picked blue earlier, actually won that game, but now this time around here with H2K, just going Vladimir themselves, they're saying, yeah, we just take the Vlad first rotation. Even banned Anivia to really set up for that Vladimir.
It was obvious.
And Exile kind of ran out of options himself, so to remove that pick from him. Suddenly you start debating if it is going to be blue side Unicorns, is it first pick Vlad suddenly happening, even though we know there are picks from Ryu against it, because this game has just been domination, honestly, from H2K, and there's so little Unicorns can do.
Yep, and with that, they get the taunt off onto Chachi. He hops, he skips, he jumps, but even in Meganar, he cannot do a damn thing. Odoamne picking up a kill for himself. Forgiven is wrecking it. H2K are just doing everything they want this game. They have gotten it all. 16 kills to 3, 9 towers, make that 10, make that 11. 30 minutes into this game, it was a quick affair, and it's all Nexus. H2K will go one game up on the cusp of a series. 2-1.
Forgiven says, you want to ban the Sivir, you want to take the Lucian, you're going to have to deal with my Tristana as a last pick. And oh boy, did he go off. 7-0-4. It wasn't one man winning this game.
No.
H2K as a unit just crushed.
Yeah. I mean, a lot of credit has to go to every single member here. Odoamne did his job perfectly down the bottom lane, even though Chachi kind of did hand it to him a little bit. He had a great game on Shen, early ganks from Jankos, and then the tower dive he set up in the mid lane. And of course, Ryu, in these fights here, reckless on this Vladimir here, not the player, but the style, diving in constantly to the back line. And despite obviously Forgiven getting all the kills, like, Ryu was great in these team fights.
Yeah.
And he did so much damage and played so well on this Vlad. And obviously a lot of value, and great for H2K to get that in first rotation and then push the enemy mid laner to something like a Victor.
Oh,
this makes it even better for H2K.
It was rough getting Rexile.
A lot of people look at it and say, well, in the laning phase, there's a lot of damage done to the Vlad by the Victor.
Oh.
Are you sure Victor's not a great pick? No, it's actually not a great pick, because when you look at the actual damage output for the rest of the game...
Even in laning phase.
Exactly, but there were trades that went that way because of the way that the queue works. But because of, as you said, the increased cost on the Hex Core, it means you essentially like half an item behind, and Ryu's just constantly catching up and just moving further and further ahead of this Victor. So I really would have liked to have seen a different pick out of Exile.
Yeah, it's a lot of questions to be answered for Unicorns this next game. I mean, was he not comfortable enough to take the Cassiopeia matchup? Do they now maybe switch side selection and think, okay, even if we do give that away, we can get ourselves two power picks the next time around? There's a lot that Unicorns are going to have to show unless they want to give this one up 3-1.
Yeah, and then again, it's the whole debate between first picking Rek'Sai or maybe taking the Vlad, because they've gone Rek'Sai all
move,
the games.
Move is good 2 out of 3 games.
Like,
on that Rek'Sai.
Yes and no. I don't think Move has been like showing up at all. I think he had a good early gank. I will agree on that one for sure. But he's not really been able to have much of an impact outside that early gank, where Jankos obviously in game 1 had a good game, and now game 3 he had a good game as well on Elise. So there's still a big difference in terms of junglers. And that is a problem for Unicorns if they feel like Rek'Sai is the comfort pick for him. Because then suddenly if they pick blue side again, you have the same situation where they might have to ban Vlad on their own. And then we've seen like multiple picks from Ryu already, and we got to see something else then from Exile. So I'm really looking forward to see what they pick. Wouldn't surprise me to see Unicorns go red side for that last game, try and get out of this situation where they trade two very good picks like the Shen as well for Odoamne over to H2K in first rotation because it has been a problem.
What I am glad to see, though, as a difference between this week and last week, is H2K with the adaptation in the pick and ban phase. The Anivia ban comes in. It's obvious what it's for.
Yeah.
But they're not just like, ah, oh, bans are great. We lost, but I think our bans are great. They've changed up. They've changed a little bit on what they're doing and put the pressure really back onto the Unicorns.
Absolutely. And Unicorns' back's against the wall. We're going to take a 3.5-minute break, but don't go anywhere.